Suppose there is a point A at some height from the ground. There is another point B which is not directly below A. You have to make a frictionless slide or curve from A to B. You are free to choose the shape of the curve. It can be any curve from a straight line to a shape taking a turn below the ground surface. The problem is to find the equation of curve such that any object slides from A to B in shortest possible time. This problem is known as Brachistochrone problem. You are watching Brain Exploders, the world where brain starts working. The word Brachistochrone comes from Greek, where Brachistos means shortest and chronos means time delay. The problem was posed by Johann Bernoulli in 1696. The curve formed is called Brachistochrone curve and its shape is same as tautochrone curve. We will discuss it in another video. The problem can be solved with several methods, but in this video we are going to discuss the solution with optimal control. The curve is independent of mass and strength of gravity, which means the shape of the curve will be same on all planets and on different altitudes. If friction is taken in account, then the curve is different from tautochrone curve. Here is our solution with optimal control. We will start with some simple conditions and by we will move towards the problem. Suppose there are two surfaces on which we can move with different speeds. From a point on the first surface, we have to reach a point on second surface in the minimum possible time. Let our speeds on both the surfaces are u and v. Since the speed remains constant till we do not change the surface, it means we should move in a straight line until we change the surface. Suppose A, B and C are the distances as shown on the screen. Let the horizontal distance after which we have to take turn is x. So the distance which we have to travel with u meter per second is root a squared plus x squared, and remaining distance is root v squared plus c minus x squared. Time taken in traveling the first part is root a squared plus x squared over u. Similarly, t2 is equal to root b squared plus c minus x squared over v. Total time is t1 plus t2. This is a function of x, and therefore to find the maxima or minima of this function, we have to put its derivative with respect to x equals to 0. We get x over u times first part of the distance minus c minus x over v times second part of this distance equals to 0. If we draw a normal on the boundary between these two surfaces and consider these angles as I and R as shown in the figure, then sin I becomes x over root a squared plus x squared, and sin R becomes c minus x over root b squared plus c minus x squared. On substituting these values and rearranging the terms, we get sin I over sin R equals to u by v. This is the phenomenon which is followed by light also and is commonly known as Snell's law in refraction. It is also supported by Fermat's principle, which states that the path taken by a ray between two points is the path that can be traversed in the least time. Let us see how it can help us. Suppose there are parallel layers of different media. Let a medium X has more than one of its layers. When a light ray enters from one medium to another, it is refracted. After multiple refractions, it passes through all the media. In any particular medium, it has a particular speed. So every time when it enters medium X, it travels with same speed, and every time its direction is parallel to a fixed direction. It means for one speed, there is only one direction. From Snell's law, we find that V over sin theta is a constant. Thus, V is equal to k sine theta, where theta is angle between light ray and normal. When an object falls under the action of gravity, its velocity starts increasing, no matter what is the shape of the curve. In this action, its potential energy is converting into kinetic energy. After going y meters below the starting point, change in potential energy is mgy, and kinetic energy becomes half mv squared. Here, for minimum time, we can replace v with k sine theta, which is the condition we just discussed. Now, let's come to the important mathematical section. Suppose curve starts from the origin of a Cartesian plane and d is the maximum depth of the curve. At maximum depth, velocity is maximum and curve is parallel to x-axis, so theta is 90 degrees. Let at any other point, distance from x-axis is y and angle between curve and negative y-axis is theta. Ratios of velocities is equal to the ratio of sine of these angles. From here, we find that y is equal to d times sine squared theta. Sine squared theta can be written as 1 minus cosine of 2 theta over 2. We have a relation between y and theta. Now we have to find the relation between x and theta. Look at the infinitesimal small part of this curve. If change in y direction is dy and change in x direction is dx, then dx by dy is equal to tan theta. Differentiating y with respect to theta, we find dy equals to 2d sin theta cos theta d theta. On substituting this value, cos theta is cancelled out, and on integrating, we get x equals to d times theta minus sin 2 theta over 2. This is a parametric equation of a cycloid. R times phi minus sin phi and R times 1 minus cos phi is usual notation, but we will keep using this with d and theta in this video. Cycloid is the locus of a point on a circle which is moving on any line performing rotational motion without slipping. In these parametric coordinates, d represents the diameter of the circle and theta is the angle between tangent to this curve and negative y-axis. Now we will calculate the time taken by the particle to reach point B from point A, which is initially at rest and starts moving under the action of gravity. On any infinitesimal small part of this curve, particle is moving neither on segment dx nor on dy, it is moving on ds. Time taken is equal to distance over velocity. So, the time taken to cover this small distance is dt equals to ds over v. From this right triangle, ds can be written equal to dy over cos theta. We have already calculated v in terms of y and y in terms of theta. On substituting these values, we get dt equals to square root 2d over g d theta. D and g are constant and initial and final values of theta are 0 and 1 respectively. Therefore, on integration, t comes out to be 2d over g times theta 1. Let us do some examples. In first example, consider that both the points are at a distance of 2 meters on the same horizontal line. In this case, theta 1 is equal to pi. We know that x is equal to d times theta minus sin 2 theta over 2. Substitute theta from pi. We find that d is equal to 2 over pi meters. Put the value of d and theta 1 in the equation of time. Required time is root 4 pi by g seconds. In second example, horizontal and vertical distances between the points are 57.05 cm and 1 meter respectively. Ratio of x and y becomes 57.05 over 100. Put the parametric coordinates in place of x and y. This ratio is approximately equal to pi minus 2 over 2 or pi by 2 minus 1 over 1 minus 0. Clearly, 2 theta is approximately equal to pi by 2 and theta is approximately equals to pi by 4. Put the value of theta in any of the parametric coordinate. It gives us the value of d. From the values of theta and d, we get required time equals to pi over 2 root g seconds. Here is one more question for you. Given horizontal and vertical distances are 4.7115 meters and 1 meter respectively. Try this question and tell us in comments. Don't forget to like and share our video, and for more such videos, subscribe to our channel Brain Explorers. Thanks for watching.